My name's Cody Gruen. I'm a senior at St. John's University, and I'm botanically inclined is one way to put it. I'm a bit of a plant nerd. I've always enjoyed everything botanical in the old sense of the word, from fungi to plants to protozoans, everything. So I started doing time lapse about 320 days ago. I know that because I set out after taking a plant physiology class here at St. John's from Dr. Steve Sopp, if you know who he is. We were introduced to time-lapse photography in that class, and we had a facility set aside in Peter Engel. In that facility, I decided, you know what, this is pretty cool. I like plants, and time-lapse offers a new way of looking at all sorts of processes that you would think would be uninteresting, if you will. I don't really like to call plants uninteresting, but I will. So I started doing different processes. I have a selection of cameras here. I've evolved through different methods. And my presentation today is basically a how-to, essentially, of all of the methods that I've kind of developed, that I've used, I should say, and what I did wrong and what I should have known, and how you guys can avoid doing certain things like that. So I do have a handout. It has some basic points. I left room at the back end of it, so if you have any notes of yourself that you'd like to take. So let's get started. So we're going to start off with a cliche, because every presentation should have at least one, but you're now entering a world of possibilities. That's as cheesy as this presentation will get, though. Literally anything can be time-lapsed. It's basically forming an illusion around a media, a digital media. You can time-lapse anything that's interesting, boring, moonscapes, cityscapes, landscapes. Anything can be time-lapsed. Even things that you would think would be boring, plants, can become interesting through this medium. That's what I really enjoy about this medium, is that even mundane things somehow can become beautiful when you watch a holistic presentation of what it actually does over time. I stole some pictures off of the internet, but I've been experimenting with different things, slime molds, candles, the flower up top. And if we have some time after question and answers at the end, I'll show a little bit of an example of some of the different products, and I have some other videos interspersed. So, this is the first note. There is two forms of time lapse. There's film time lapse and there's photographic time lapse. The difference being what subject you're going to film or record. Photographic time lapse is more applicable to certain things that take a long time for them to unfold. For instance, flowers blooming over 8 days, et cetera, et cetera. Film is more readily applied to certain things that last a long time, but there's a lot of stuff going on within. So I showed a picture on the previous slide. This is a highway, right? But you can see that everything is really blurred. This is something that you could film with film time lapse. This was filmed with, well, this individual photograph was taken and then added into a photographic time lapse by manipulating your shutter speed to get these blurry lines. That's something that you can evolve and figure out later. So all of my plants, though, don't really do a lot of stuff that could be used for film. I have tried it, and I do not recommend it. It's very hard to edit all the film together. So finally, that's my introduction. What are we going to cover today? My basic plan is to go over what is time-lapse. We kind of already touched on that. What do you need for time-lapse? How to set up a time-lapse? And then once you know what you're doing, kind of basically, how do you proceed into higher quality films? So what is time lapse? As I already mentioned, it's an in-between. It's a production of stills, photographs, that you then convert into the frames in a video. If you guys know, you might have heard 30 frames per second. Every photo becomes one frame. And you can manipulate that, though. There's a lot of play. It doesn't have to be 30 frames per second. It can be 24, 15. Slows the playback down. So in 1 minute, if you set your camera to take 1 minute interval photos, there's 60 minutes in an hour. At 60 photos converted into 30 frames per second of video, you have 2 seconds of video. Now, that's just 1 hour. I've done time lapse of hundreds of hours, 183 hours. So you can quickly amass hundreds, thousands of photos. The most that I've ever attempted was a 15-day time lapse that incorporated, by the time it was over, 18,000 photographs into one clip. If we have time, I can, if you're interested, after everything, I can show that. But like I said, it gives a sense of motion to the motionless. That's the beauty of it. It's an illusion. So here's just one example. Notice that this is, you can't really see it, it's 2,300 photographs that I then compiled into this finished product. I'll just play a quick clip of it. There's no sound. The coloring is a little off from the projector, but now, this is still manipulated further. This is the very first compilation of images. This was 2,300 photos, and it played in about 30 seconds. So if you can do the math on the fly and you're some sort of genius, which I'm not because I had to do this before, that should be about a minute and 15 seconds. And that's what this compiled into. So this would be very slow. Notice it's opening at a much slower rate. Why is this ever useful to do this kind of time lapse? Well, here you can you're going to be converting now into 30 seconds, and you're going to take down frames, but it's always better, this is an important point, it's always better to take more pictures than what would be needed than to not have enough pictures. Because you can work down from more pictures, but you can't work up when your video is really choppy. So what do you need? Let's get down to the real basics of how to do this. First, you'll need a camera. There's a variety of cameras. You can use a $10 webcam. Everyone knows what a webcam is. Or you can go all the way up. This is what I use now. It's about a $600 DSLR, digital single reflex camera, something like that. It's fancy. Or you can use, I don't have one of these on the end. That's a Nikon D4. That's about $6,000. Little overkill for what you need to do. But within it, with everything, as you have higher quality cameras, they usually cost more. This was taken from a webcam, this one right here on the left. That's a little plant, it's an on that spins. Notice it's a little bit, it's about standard definition. It's kind of fun, it's a kind of fun film. This one was taken from a Nikon S210, the second one in. And we'll fast forward through the boring parts. But it takes pretty good video. Pretty nice video, actually, I like it. And then this one was taken from this Nikon P90, which is also up here. And there you go. That was actually my very first time lapse I've ever done. So it was kind of, you know, one of those things, like if I hadn't done a really nice one, then maybe I wouldn't have started going farther. But but turned out well. Now, you're going to need an SD card, perhaps. That's a big one. You may not need an SD card. My system involves no SD card. If you're going to spend money, it's OK to get a big one. May not be needed. You will need a tripod. You will need a tripod, and in quotations. You will go into it further and later in the presentation, but you cannot move the camera once it starts. Once you start the time lapse, no more messing around with it. That's one of the tenets that I have of time lapse photography. These are very handy. You can get any manipulated angle. If you have, for instance, if you had a plant here, or if you had a person that was, you're doing a photo a day, for instance, and you have a child that you want to take a photo to see and then compile it after 10 years, you want to have a uniform height. So either some sort of stand or tripod that it can always be brought back to the same increment so the camera position doesn't change. There's some rules. One piece of advice. Don't be afraid to use tape. I'm not above making some monstrous thing, taping a camera onto the tripod or onto a wall. Your product won't show how uncreative you were, when you were mounting the camera. So don't be afraid to take chances on that. Webcams can be kind of tricky. That's where tape comes in. Not many webcams come with tripod attachments. You will also need an AC power source. If you buy the $6,000 camera, you might be able to get 6 hours out of the battery life. But for any of the films that I'd be doing, I would quickly run out. So they're all over the internet. You can buy a $14 one, or you can buy a $20 name brand one. This is a $14 one. I'm just not throwing it against the wall. I'm sure the name brand one wouldn't break, but I'm not trusting this one as much. But it serves a purpose, and they've never broken. So any AC power adapter will work. Intervalometer. Now, this is where you're getting into some technical terms. An intervalometer is basically an exterior plug-in to a camera. On this DSLR, there's grooves on the side. There'll always be some sort of attachment in which you can plug in to an intervalometer or other means, USB, etc. An intervalometer would be a little extension right here. You can see the handle, and it's basically a shutter stop. You can, independent from the shutter stop on the camera, you can take photos, but you can also set intervals for when you want your camera to be taking pictures so you can leave. This is important. You won't have to sit there and literally touch a camera for 2,300 photos like I did or something like that. I didn't actually do that, so. Now, there are certain ways of getting around this. You can spend $20 on one or $100. If you're going to buy an intervalometer, if you need it for what I'm about to say, I'd go with a name brand one. They'd be very trustworthy. I don't use an intervalometer. What I use is, when I bought this Canon Rebel T3i, it comes with two CDs, an instructional manual and some freeware. The freeware that comes with it will actually run the camera from the computer. And I mean everything except for the actual focusing. This focus ring right here, everything can be controlled from a computer. If you get a USB extension cord, I could be putting this in the hallway and run a cord over here to the computer and manipulate anything that I wanted to, including an interval timer. So you can set incredible increments, like 1 second, 24 seconds, anything. So that comes really handy. And then finally, you will want to have some sort of editing software. There's three softwares that I advise: Stop Motion Pro, Final Cut Pro 10, and Adobe Premiere Pro. Now, the last two that we watched, this one and this one, these are something that I'd work up to. This is very professional. It's an extremely powerful software. It's incredible. I've been using it for however many days, and basically I just know how to do a few basic things, and once I learn, my films have an added, flash to them. This is pretty good software. It's very good, and it's a bit cheaper. More or less, though, these two softwares are on Macs. But what I would start with, you can see I have what Cody's advice is for beginners. I would start with this Stop Motion Pro. The big benefit of it is that it has free trial versions of it. Yes, there's a watermark on the trial videos that you make, but they're trial videos. It's to try out the process. Then you can buy $50 versions of it if you would like. This is on PC, yes. You can get versions of the other softwares on PCs as well. The beauty of the software, though, and all time-lapse, photographic time-lapse, is when you learn if you can get something to work in one with a webcam and a free trial version of Stop Motion Pro and have spent $30, you will have learned the skill that you need to go and work up to a $6,000 camera and some fancy software from Hollywood for another $1,000 or whatever you'd want to do.
Would you use iMovie?
I have not used iMovie, but I've heard this is through the grapevine, but you can manipulate through iMovie to get the frames per second that you'd need to.
I know it's very hard. I've tried to do stop motion and it's tedious.
Mm-hmm.
It's just very tedious work. Do you know of any way to do it in a more efficient way, or have you learned any way?
Yeah, we might be able to talk afterwards. There might be some cheats that you can work through. But basically, you import the video, all the images, and you put them to one frame per second. There's various ways. If you read the manual, they're meant to instruct you on how to do that, so it's wonderful. So here's a little bit. There's a lot of text here, so it's going to be compiled down into pros and cons of the three different systems. We have webcams, small digitals, these type, and then high quality DSLR photography. The pros of a webcam is they're cheap. You can take a webcam and it can be purchased for the sole purpose of running time-lapse photography. Someday I may have kids, and maybe in like 15, 20 years, maybe, we'll see. But when I have children, I'd like to be able to do a photo a day series for 10 years. If you wanted to, you can take a webcam, buy a $10 webcam, get a tripod or a wood frame, anything. And you can take screws and mount the webcam there. You won't ever have to use this again for anything else. And it's not a huge investment that you feel bad about making that only usable for one thing. The cons of webcams, their standard definition are below. Even if a webcam says it's HD, it won't be HD. It might be close to standard definition, or it could be standard definition, but it won't be 1080i or 1080p. The next step up are these compact digital cams. These are wonderful. Here's another good note for you. This is the Nikon S210, Coolpix S210, and this is the Nikon Coolpix P90. They do not make these anymore, but I tell you this because they have them on the internet. You can find anything on the internet, including these. These would be highly sought after. If you can find one on eBay used, I would buy it because these are incredibly versatile. You take this little camera, I was able to run around all over the countryside filming things as long as I had an extension cord. I even brought these into, if anyone knows, forest mushrooms down the road. I filmed mushrooms growing with these cameras. These are nice because they have dedicated time-lapse mode. I have Nikons in parentheses because Nikon, for some time, I don't know why they stopped, was installing dedicated time-lapse mode into their cameras. Which means if you buy these two types of cameras, you set it up, you expose it how you want, we'll go over that, you click take the picture, you come back 30 hours later, and you open up the memory, and you have a video ready to be watched. There's no post-production involved. There's no software, anything. Those are wonderful, and if you can find one, buy it.
What's this other one called?
This is a Nikon Coolpix P90. In fact, I can pass these around if you'd like to see them later. Or if you want to come up afterwards, feel free to inspect them. Digital SLRs. There is one. Just one digital SLR that you can buy that would do the Nikon feature. It's a Nikon, and it's the D4, which is $6,000. That's something that I would really like to buy, but, you know, I'm a senior, and I have other plans other than spending that much money on a camera. But this SLR, you can get, the Rebel series is very, very affordable, actually. And the beauty of it, it's Canon. All Canon come with the software EOS utility, as long as you have a camera that says on the front of it, EOS, right here. And you can use the method that I use that I'm gonna go over in a little bit. They're extremely versatile. You're able to manipulate everything. When I was able to make the jump to DSLRs, I was lucky enough to be able to write a grant and have it approved by the school to purchase this. I was able to really get into the professional filmmaking. These cameras, one word of advice, and this is another important thing, they have three different settings of capturability. The first one is 4,000 by 3,000, 35, and then something else. Those are random numbers, whatever. Big, medium, little pictures. The big setting pictures, to play your movies with the big setting pictures appropriately and not lose quality, you have to buy a $38,000 TV. Yeah, it's called 4K. In a few years, maybe like 20 years, it might be $1,000. But you know what? I didn't realize that, and I was taking about 75 gigabytes a day worth of pictures. Quickly found out that that was the issue, but at least I'll have 17 movies now that I'll be able to play on 4K when. Yeah, in 17 years, I'll be able to have really cool movies. So word of advice, that's a big note. Make sure that you capture an S1 or S2. It's like blocks, and it means small. So that finishes our materials. Now I'm going to take a pause. Is there any questions here? This is my first time doing the presentation, so I don't want to go too fast. Is there anybody, any questions at all? All right, good. All right, then we're going to go into filming, setting up a shot. And I have a little bit on this note-taking skills that I have. There's a little bit of a cheat sheet that it's a kind of a walkthrough. And like I said, as soon as you learn one style of setting up these time-lapse, it's universal. You can set up any time-lapse, however you want. But the basic universal laws of time-lapse. Figure out your shot. When people ask me about my time-lapse, I tell them that I have to be three different things. A third of a botanist, because I film only botanical things. I have to know what I'm filming and why I'm filming it and what I should be looking at when I'm filming it. I have to be a third photographer. That's a hard word for me to remember for some reason. I have to be a third photographer because you have to know how you're exposing the pictures. You have to be able to manipulate the aperture and the shutter speed, figure out what ISO that you're at. All things that I learned at by putting a camera on the tripod and just, okay, click this, mess around with this, that's what it looks like. Easy stuff to learn. And then you have to be third clairvoyant, because I'm speaking from experience. Your subjects don't know that they're being filmed, and they don't know how to act, and they might not act how you want them to. So I have gigabytes of photos that I at one point thought were garbage because the pea tendril didn't curl around the rod, or the fungus didn't move through the petri dish how I wanted it to, or it came out of focus, or different things. But I stand up here today knowing what I know now. Those are easily remedied mistakes with just a little bit of knowledge about messing around with the cameras. I didn't mess around with the settings of the different cameras that I was using until I had been filming for 175 days and stuff like that. So I had a whole bunch of poor films that I could have made really well. And the cheat sheet hopefully will help you not make those mistakes. No picture, when you see it, and if the plant or your subject doesn't follow what you want it to do, it's not a garbage film. There's still something to be gained from that. So don't ever delete things unless you really have to. That's another moral that I would say. So when taking your, the next law that I have is when setting up, mess with all the shutter speeds, everything, and shoot in manual mode. A few of these small digital cameras, they have the ability to shoot in manual mode, and I'd advise that. In the DSLRs, if you work your way up to those, the only thing that manual mode does really to the camera is you have to focus by manually, but then you can have full range of motion with all of the different features. The third law, once you've set up the camera, do not touch it. You're making an illusion that your viewer will be watching, and no one is going to think that the screen has a flower inside of it, obviously. But if all of a sudden your flower, whatever your, I'm biased to plants, so if your flower all of a sudden is opening and then it jerks over here and opens farther, it kind of ruins the idea that what I'm watching unfold is happening in real time. So don't touch the camera. That also includes do not try to change settings once you start the film. Changing your settings will do the same effect as moving the camera would. And maintain a constant capture rate. If you want to, you can always go down in capture rate. It's inverse related. So if you have a 30-second capture rate, your playback will be slower. The motion will happen slower because you're capturing less movement per picture. If you capture every 5 minutes, that's a longer interval, more movement is happening per picture. Don't change that unless you actually want to intentionally. If it's just because you're running out of space, don't mess around with that. Because it'll cause your whatever you're filming, your subject will move, and then all of a sudden it'll move at a faster rate for some reason that no one will know except for you. But there's certain things I'll show when, if we have time, I'll show a film, and I'll mention this is one instance that I did that. And unless your goal is to have yourself in the film, I've done a lot of fun films where 2 weeks ago, my roommates, I live in an apartment on campus, and my roommates went down, they were playing computer games for 6 hours because we had a snow day on Monday. Yeah, this was just this week, my goodness. So at 3 hours into it, I set up a time lapse, and Those are situations where, you know, you want something to happen and you can be in the film. But when you're trying to make one of these flower opening films or anything else, you don't want to have fingers or water squirting, you know, watering the plant, whatever. So my rule of thumb is only go into this location that you're trying to film. If you can set up a single location, go in there only to check on things, but don't try to monkey around with stuff. Because like I said, nothing ruins the video more than bumping the camera. Oh, did I move it back on accident? Well, that was this one was. All right, so what do I do? I'll go over it real quick. I take this camera. It comes with a USB cable. That's something to note. I plug it into the camera, into the computer, and I install the EOS software. And I have a whole list of things, of step-by-step instructions online that you can contact me with if you'd like those. And then I use Adobe Premiere, some lights, backdrops, and I have a large external hard drive to store all these images on. It's incredibly simple, and it is, like I said, it's universal. I learned the same system that I'm using on this very fancy professional camera I learned on webcams. So maybe that's a feel-good quote. Start small and work your way up to really cool stuff. Post-production is a very easy process. Same thing, you just have to figure out through the instruction manuals, because there's various ways of doing it. You figure out how to import your pictures, and then you change the rate in Adobe Premiere and in Final Cut. It's just control duration rate. You make it down to 1 second. And in the version that I'm recommending you get, Stop Motion Pro, when you start a new project, if you're using the computer, if you start a new project, it will immediately ask you what rate of import do you want, how many frames per second do you want imported, and then you import batch, and it's done, and you export as an AVI file. So that's very simple software. Once you develop more complicated techniques and high-quality techniques, then you can branch out into the higher softwares. So increasing level of difficulty. Is there any other questions?
Does it always export as an AVI, or can it be different formats?
In the free version of Stop Motion Pro, that is only AVI. But if you get other versions of Stop Motion Pro, there's different programs that they use for different stop motion films. Stop motion is like a claymation, Wallace and Gromit, if that rings any bells, things like that. The free version is very useful for using that software. I've made claymations in the lab for fun, for some reason, I don't know why. So that exports as AVI, but all the other versions will export into MOV, H.264, everything that you'd want. So, quick time. Is there any other questions? Okay. And this is kind of nearing the end of my spiel, so I'm gonna leave some time for questions and answers afterwards and maybe show some videos. But remember, this is a very easy process to do. As long as you remember a few things that I have written down in this handout, you can easily make beautiful films. The first is, as interval of time that you're filming increases, so the real time, going from 1 hour to 8 days, you run the risk of messing up, essentially, more than you would if you were just filming it for 1 hour. So bear that in mind. When you're going in, you should look. Do I have room? I have a cheat sheet on the back side of it. It says, in this many hours, I will, at this interval, I'll capture this many photos. When you start, you should know, will I have enough photos at this interval to capture enough photos throughout this entire process that I want to film? Because you don't want to, I ran out on Monday, I ran out of photos at 12:02 a.m. at midnight. And I didn't go in to check until 8 hours later. And the flower that was blooming had bloomed, and I missed it. So I started over, and it's been running. Actually, I just shut it down right before I came over here. So it was a success story, but I was really disheartened. That's the first film that I've screwed up in, I don't know, 50 days. So it was a bad Monday, guys. We had a snow day, but it was still terrible. The next one, high-definition films take more time to edit. They take software. Don't be discouraged by that. The software is very easy. No software programmer is going up thinking, how can I make those people that want to buy this How can I stump them into not figuring out my software? The manuals are very easy to follow. I was lucky enough to have some of my instructions given to me person to person by professionals. I started off looking at manuals, and it was easy to follow. Standard definition films may be what you want to have your ultimate goal be. Maybe what you want to film is perfectly fine done with this $50 camera that you can find on the internet. That is fine. But know that if you want to go up into the high quality stuff, the only thing that hinders you is the cost. There's no anyone here, if you can film on a webcam, if you can set up one of these easy to do, push the button and it's done kind of thing, you can produce high quality films. And just remember, practice. That's the only reason I got good at making films, is I sat down and I said, I want to make films about plants because I'm passionate about plants, and I just practiced. So, any questions? Oh, go ahead.
What about a subject, for example, the bird's nest? I mean, sure, you could watch the eggs, but then if you have a parent, for example, flying in, wouldn't that make for a really
choppy look?
Or even tough to follow. Your viewer would be confused.
I can see where you're coming from. There would be a lot of motion at times, but. For instance, in the bird nest situation, a lot of times if there's eggs in the nest, they'll be sitting. So they'll just be putzing around, looking around everywhere. And it'll be very interesting. And when they're flying and gone, yes, they might appear and disappear randomly. But that's okay, because what you're trying to capture is the holistic sense. And they will abruptly leave the nest to get food and come back. So I don't think those would be issues that you'd have to worry about, actually. So I think you should try it. That'd be very cool.
Can you show us that?
Yes, I have a compilation of various time lapses. It's about 6 minutes long. And if anyone else has any questions, yes.
If you try to do lots of times it's a plant growing.
Correct. Yes.
And can you do one outside when it's daylight and darkness and rain?
Yes, that's a good question. Actually, rain I don't know about. Make sure you wrap up your camera, but. The changes you'll see in this, if I have time to show it, changes due to natural lighting, the sun going and coming back, what have you, those are perfectly fine, and they add an element of reality to it. To a certain extent, it depends on what you want to capture and show your viewer. For instance, in some of my videos, I didn't want to show. I wanted to just show the process and have nothing else to show other than the process of flowers opening or seeds growing or germinating. But there's many, many films that I've done that involved being in the greenhouse, and you can see that, all of a sudden there will be one that I'll point out, and we actually saw the beginning of it, that white flower that bloomed. That's a night blooming flower. If I had brought that into the studio to film with constant light, you would have lost that piece that it only blooms at night. The peacock flower, the second one that I showed, you see it up here as well. That's another night blooming one. So no, I think you should definitely consider doing films outside to have that natural element. And it's very easy. Any of these cameras can be hooked up to an intervalometer that runs on AA batteries.
So if you have it every so often at night, would you have it so it automatically, you leave your flash on auto, so it flashes if it needs to flash?
Interesting, yes. The flash works. Actually, those videos that I showed at night, those were lit by flash. That's one option. I've also done other situations in which I've done it post-editing. I've done cutting it apart, so I didn't want the night to be shown. It just shows it getting dark, and then immediately gets light again. So, And that's easy stuff to do once you know the software. Other questions? No? All right, does anybody want to watch the 6 minute long clip? It's pretty good. It was a very good feeling after 500 hours worth of work plus and 4,000 hours of films to be able to compile this to show you guys. So I hope you enjoy it. It was very good. I actually, one thing I'll say is that I wouldn't have been able to do some of this stuff without advisors. So I'm very, very grateful for all the advisors I've had. They've helped me out a lot and showed me different things about filming. And I hope that I kind of fulfilled a role like that for you now. But if I don't have time to say, I want to say this now if I don't have time afterwards. I'm more than happy to be, open to questions that you'd have. I have contact information, hopefully that you see it on the back of the sheet. If you have emails, feel free to send me an email about any questions that you have. How does this work? What is this thing? What does this mean? And I would try my hardest to answer your questions. So. All right, we'll see what we have here. Yeah. Well, we'll see if the music is on or not. Oh. Here we go. Those are peas. Peas, the imbibition process of peas taking in water. This is done in a studio. I'll point out some of the different locations if you'd like. Yeah, no worries. Many attempts at filming these things. This is the fifth film that I did to get these to actually grow appropriately, yeah. Did you see that in speed up? That was a changing of the intervals. Notice there'll be a flash here. These are some of the mistakes as well, so I can point out. There'll be the flash there was because somebody turned on the lights in the room, so.
Oh. And so what was the time interval
when something? Oh yeah, I can say this is every 2 minutes. If you remember the yellow orchids, that was an 8-day one. The yellow flowers that opened up. I can kind of comment. This is overnight, every 30 seconds. This is the S210, the little pink one that I held up. This is natural lighting. This is in the greenhouse. Otherwise, you can use desk lamps. I filmed in an empty bedroom in my apartment over break. This is real film, what I don't advise. This is a tape put into a player. Took a long time to edit. This is also tape. This is the only time lapse, I believe, of this plant ever. This is a webcam. These are the two small cams, the little pink one. Thank you. So, you just watched 4,212 hours of real time. So at St. John's, we had this summer, we had agave Victoriae reginae that bloomed. It's a very, not rare species of agave, but they flower once in their life cycle and then they die. And their flower stalks are 25 feet tall on average. They reach that height. So I was filming those on a small camera on top of a very tall tripod on top of blocks and carts, 15 feet, 20 feet in the air. So it was very challenging, and it was want to move. So, is there any questions? Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was really lucky. The plant was 40, 50 years old. Yeah. So. All right. Well, you guys now see that it's doable. It's very easy. Yes, sir. Yes, that's a very good question. What I would do is film through a window inside, or if sometime in my future and I have disposable income, if you will, I might buy an intervalometer, and they make waterproof cases that are very affordable, $20 to encase that inside of a plexiglass see-through case, and you could film anything you want through, rain, snow, everything. So, very good question. Oh, thank you. Well, this is a sample of that I use as a teaching tool because there's some imperfections. But this coming spring in the CSBSJU student film festival, I'll be putting a full version of the film up if you're interested in showing for that. So. No, that's where you come in with manual focus. So you'll want to switch it on this DSLR, and some of these don't have manual focus. This one does. You flip it over here on the lens, and then you can move the focus ring manually, and then it sits, and you won't ever have to worry about it changing focus on you.
Even though that some things may be moving closer to the lens,
focus, can you use auto focus? Yes, very, very wonderful question there. That's very good job on that. I should have brought that up maybe. That is an issue solved by messing with your depth of field. That's your aperture. There's lots of inside the manuals that come with the camera that would have been explained, but the depth of field essentially says how much of what I'm filming will be in focus. So if you've seen those macro shots where I'm looking at something here, but everything behind it is out of focus, that's with a very small aperture. I forget which one, because it's inverse related. But if you wanted to keep everything in focus, you'd make that f-stop number on your camera very high. So.
And why not the autofocus? What would that do?
Autofocus is an issue that arises with autofocus is that as your subject is changing in time, it may be moving in and out away from the camera, and it may focus on something all of a sudden that you don't want to be focusing on. For instance, all of my these are unedited. This is just setting the plant farther away from the back lighting or the backdrop, excuse me. If I would leave it on autofocus at any random time, if my subject moved out of too much of the centered balance of where my camera is auto-focusing on, it may say, okay, there's nothing where this lady is standing, so I'm gonna I might focus on the wall now. And my whole film from that point on would be out of focus. So that is why you would want to use manual focus. Good questions, thank you. Anything else? Please pick up a little handout. It has my contact information on the backside, and feel free to contact me whenever you want. So, thank you.